We live on a water planet. 73% of the surface of our planet is the sea. On average, it's 4,000 meters deep. And at its deepest point, it's 2 kilometers deeper than Mount Everest is high. And it gives us 98% of the habitable area on the planet. And if you think about it, it's really obvious.
On land, it's pretty two-dimensional. Most creatures live on the surface. But in the sea, everything happens under the surface. And in every real sense, the sea is the planet. And you might ask, what does the ocean do for us? Well, I'm going to invite you to take a deep breath. And now take another deep breath. And the oxygen from that second breath, that comes from the ocean. And of course, it's not just for us. It's for all the creatures and plants on the planet. But it also absorbs 90% of the excess heat that we humans produce through climate change. And of course, it gives us food. It feeds billions of people and much more. In tourism and medicine and transport. But asking the question, what does the ocean do for us? That's the wrong question. The right question is, what do we do for the ocean? And here we can talk about a pyramid of catastrophe. In one corner, we have extraction of protein in fish and the coming specter of deep sea mining. In the last 50 years alone, we've taken nearly 90% of all the big predator fish out of the ocean. And the ecosystem has been vastly damaged because of it. And in the very near future, we have the specter of deep sea mining, which we must avoid or delay at all costs. And then we have pollution. So in pollution, we can start to talk about plastics. 10 million tons of plastic flow into the ocean every single year. And they break down from macroplastics to microplastics and then nanoplastics, tiny molecular particles of plastics that get eaten by the small fish, that get eaten by bigger fish, and then we eat the bigger fish. And those tiny particles of nanoplastics, they go into our brain. And each and every one of us has this much microplastics and nanoplastics in our brain. And this is a public health epidemic that is coming towards us and we are not prepared. But it's not just the plastics. We have forever chemicals produced over the last 100 years by industrial processes, PCBs and PFAS, and likewise, they come up through the food chain. And we have eutrophication. So this is the nitrogen that is put on our fields as fertilizers and washes away down the rivers and into the seas and produces dead zones, areas where there's not enough oxygen to support life and there's no plants and there's no animal life. I was born on a really tiny island. And like many island people all over the world, the love for the sea is just innate within me. But from a very early age, I was really interested in climate as well. And that's why in 1992, when the Rio Earth Summit happened, I was so excited. Over 100 heads of state attended that summit, thousands of scientists. And at the end, they published a protocol and they nailed it. They understood what the problems were and they clearly laid out the solutions. And then in 2015, the world got together in Paris, and it was a great moment of hope for the climate movement. We agreed as a global community to keep temperatures underneath 1.5 degrees. And here we are, 33 years after that summit, and we're moving backwards. We're moving backwards on pollution. We're moving backwards in terms of overfishing. And of course, our climate is accelerating away with warming. Surely a more advanced society would already not be talking about, but would be enacting a pyramid of hope. One where we're not overfishing, but no, we're sustainably taking fish out of the ocean, and we're certainly not contemplating deep sea mining. And instead of pollution, we'd be talking about circular economies. We've been talking about this for decades. We just haven't implemented it. And instead of climate, we'd be talking about energy. We have a fusion reactor up in the sky. We didn't pay for it. We don't have to maintain it. But yet every hour, it gives us more energy than humanity consumes in a year. And why is this? Ultimately, it's a failure of governance. And outside of the marine environment, we see this everywhere, with increasing wars and tribalism and the greed that capitalism injects into our society. It almost feels like a very small number of people are prepared to finance us all into oblivion in order to fatten their own wallets. And the scientists are screaming at us. They're screaming at us about climate because we're going too slowly. And they're screaming about artificial intelligence because we're going too quickly. AI is an incredible set of technologies. And there are dystopian pathways and very hopeful pathways in front of us. We must redouble our efforts to use AI for good. And the company that I founded 2 years ago, Subsea, that is our absolute focus. So I want to talk to you a little bit about AI in the marine environment. And there are some fantastically exciting projects happening. From Global Fishing Watch, who take satellite data and use machine learning to interpret the movements of fishing vessels. And where they see vessels who are in the wrong place or doing the wrong thing, to report that to authorities. And then there's SETI, a group who are working to decode the language of sperm whales. We can expect within 2 years that we will understand the vocabulary and the grammar of what these magnificent mammals are talking about. And when we do, we will learn that they love their families just as much as we love ours. And we'll learn about their incredible heritage and culture. And we'll listen to them talking to each other about where's all the food gone? And where has all the food gone? We've eaten it. And we'll listen to them talk about this incredible noise in the ocean, this noise pollution that disturbs their migratory patterns. And outside of that, we can talk about ecosystem modeling. And this is incredibly exciting. Ecosystems are super complex. But already today, we can model simple ecosystems. And in the very near future, we'll be at a stage where we can model the entire marine ecosystem. And when we do, we will learn that that pyramid of catastrophe is only a very, very small part of the damage that we've already done to the global marine environment. We are on the cusp of getting climate change very badly wrong. We're not moving fast enough, and we're not moving at scale. But just maybe there's an opportunity for us to use these incredibly powerful technologies and marry them with the wisdom of 3.8 billion years of evolution and change in the ocean. And maybe that will take humanity by the hand and lead us down the path to a successful outcome. Now, I'd like to leave you with a quote from what I believe the ocean would say if it could speak today. I give you life. And all I ask in return is respect. Don't poison me. Don't steal from me. If my heart stops beating, so will yours. Thank you.